Well, it looks like you're the one who needs to be taught a lesson, pal. Class is paying 101. Your instructor's Casey Jones.
Look, I don't want to fight you.
Well, tough rocks, pal.
It's a cup of coffee in the big time, yeah. Cup of coffee in the big time.
Hey, what do you say we both be independent together, huh?
All right, we have the tools, we have talent. It's Miller time.
I said empty your mind. Be formless, shapeless, like water. Now you put water into a cup, it becomes the cup. You put water into a bottle, it becomes the bottle. You put it in a teapot, it becomes the teapot. Now water can flow or it can crash. Be water, my friend.
The world ain't all sunshine and rainbows. It's a very mean and nasty place, and I don't care how tough you are, it will beat you to your knees and keep you there permanently if you let it. You, me, or nobody is gonna hit as hard as life. But it ain't about how hard you hit. It's about how hard you can get hit and keep moving forward. How much you can take and keep moving forward. That's how winning is done. Now, if you know what you're worth, now go out and get what you're worth. But you gotta be willing to take the hits and not pointing fingers saying you ain't where you want to be because of him or her or anybody. Cowards do that, and that ain't you. You're better than that.
Well, that's great. Either I have a monster in my kitchen or I'm completely crazy.
I don't think you're crazy.
You know something? Maybe I am insane.
You know what you need? You need a Brazilian plastic surgeon.
I've got one that can see.
It's showtime.
Hey, everybody. What's up? How's it going? Welcome. This is Comic Book Radio, and I'm your host, Peter Cimetti. This is episode 125. My guest tonight is Aaron Lopresti. We're going to be talking about adventures in science fiction and cosmic space fantasy. He's got a cool looking book out on Indiegogo right now called Kit Carter. And we'll be discussing that along with the motivations for creating such a book and what that means to Aaron. Before we get started, I want to say hello to those of you in the chat. We got Citizen Ronin here. What's up, Citizen Ronin? Fritzy Schnitzel is here too. How's it going? Kelraiser in the house. What's up? Marcus Kellergrew is here. How's it going, Marcus? Jet Ojaga. What's up, Jet Ojaga? Jason Duran is here and said, is there prizes for showing up early? No, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, there are not. But you have my deepest and sincere thanks. Sark, what's up, Sark? Hope you're doing well. We got Passmaster Dan in the house, too. Hey, Jefferson Roswell is here as well. Says, greetings. What a great topic. Science fiction and space fantasy with Aaron Lopresti. Wizard Sleeves is here, too. What's up, Wizard Sleeves? Wizard Sleeves is very excited about the show. Wants to know if Aaron will talk about using, I'm guessing, Bernie Wrightson as an influence mixed with sci-fi. Interesting. Spaceman is here, coming down from above. What's up, Spaceman? Hope you're doing good. We also have, let's see, Jeff Kimbler in the house. How's it going, Jeff? Hope you're doing well. We got Leg Kick 1 here, too. What's up, Leg Kick? Manny Cornejo in the house. How's it going? Goody Two Shoes is here. What's up, Goody Two Shoes? Let's see here. We also have, I want to make sure I'm saying hello to everybody before we get started. Dr. Mask. What's up, Dr. Mask? Hope you're doing well. Thank you for being here tonight. Let's see, does demonetized mean no channel memberships anymore? Yeah. So every video is always demonetized. I voluntarily do that, and then the clips and whatnot, and the music on the intro always demonetizes them. No channel strikes, no copyright strikes, nothing like that. It's just demonetized. But the channel itself has been demonetized because of reasons that are unknown. Or at least unexplained to me. So if anybody missed the community post, the YouTube videos I've done, the past two of them, I mentioned it, the Twitter post, that type of thing too. YouTube has found that most of my content and this is their words in an email, does not follow their guidelines for monetization, so they've revoked that ability until the end of February, when I can apply again. And I will be monetized again, and I won't do anything different, and it'll be like, that was strange. I tell you, it's going to happen. They did it to me last November, got remonetized in February, and now they're doing it again. Strange. So, yeah, no channel memberships, though. Dan Genovese, what's up, Dan? If anybody wants to support me or the channel, even if I was monetized, I suggest go to alternatecomics.com, pick up some great comics. Don't just give YouTube money, especially they get 30% of that, and don't just, you know, throw out a... I read all the stuff anyway. You know, pester me enough if you've got a question and I'll read it. You don't need to super chat or anything like that. Go get comics instead. Get something for your buck. We also have, let's see, Bobo Ayami's here too. What's up, Bobo? Dan Genovese over here too. What's up, Dan? We also have Jake Blues in the house. How's it going, Jake? And Johnny Slaction is here. What's up? Yeah, I'm not even deterred in the slightest. I'm like, oh, curious. That's about it. I'm not going to do anything different. Not going to talk about anything different. We don't do anything that crazy on this channel anyway. I guess. Maybe to some people we do. But we don't. All right. Without further ado, let's bring him on. The man of the hour. The very talented, the very awesome. He's been on here before. This is the return of Mr. Aaron Lopresti. What's up, Aaron?
Hey, Pete. Thanks for having me on again. I was actually surprised when he asked me to come back. I was like, man, I was just on there. He must really like me.
Believe it or not, you were on almost 100 episodes ago.
Was it that long ago?
Yeah, well, I do almost every day. So oh, I do five to 6 days a week, but still.
That's still, you know, that's a good, what, 3 or 4 months worth of material.
Yeah. There. You were on episode 30.
And what episode are we on now?
125.
Wow, man. It's I think maybe it should be a regular thing. It's almost like an anniversary thing every, 100 episodes.
Every 100 episodes? Yeah,
yeah, exactly. You can do that. Just bring me back. There you go.
I like talking to you enough I could have you on every single month. Hell, every week, but, you know, we're busy.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that, Pete. No, we've had good conversations. I've had you on my show, and it's been a blast. So
absolutely. 100%. Yeah, so I'm really happy and excited to have you back on again tonight. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm digging the way... The look of your book, the sound of your book, I think it looks pretty cool. People are enjoying it and digging it too. It's Kit Carter, of course, is what I'm talking about. How did that come about? What was the inspiration for all of that?
You know, that it's a very strange story in the sense. Thanks, Lance Ryder. Appreciate that. I never had any sort of inkling to do a narrative story with the character. She was originally conceived as concept for a sketchbook cover. And one thing I learned very early on in my career, this is about 2011, maybe somewhere in that neighborhood. So, you know, over a decade ago, but you know, you put a chick on the cover of your sketchbook, it sells 10 times better than even if you put a monster or something that I would normally put on. And so I was like, well, let's see, what can I do? And so I've always been kind of a fan of EC Comics and like the, you know, the sci-fi stuff that Al Williamson did and some of the great stories that he did inked by Frazetta. And then, of course, Wally Wood and guys like that. And, of course, we've seen like tons of images of the Bubble Helmet Space Girl. They were in pulp magazines for crying out loud, but they, you know. William Stout has a great one that used to show up in the comic book price guide all the time. And it was advertising for some dealer. I can't remember who it was now, but it was a great piece. And of course, Dave Stevens did stuff in the 80s for Pacific Comics. And they would always sort of do this sort of Marilyn Monroe looking, space girl. And so I just thought, wouldn't it be kind of funny if I designed the sketchbook cover to be sort of like a B movie from the 50s, you know, with the sci-fi Bubble Helmet Girl. And the first concept thing I came up with was Kit Carter versus the Astro Zombies. And that was this, you know, that's what I came up with. And so I put it on I was going to use it on the sketchbook cover, but then it was like, became such an elaborate piece. I thought, well, I'm going to turn this into a print. so I had, and I did a simpler piece on the sketchbook cover. And so what happened was I did the print, and then I had people immediately at shows start asking me, is this a series? You know, is it, what are you doing with this? When's this coming out? You know? And I was like, never. And so I did another one called Kit Carter versus the Molten Menace.
How long ago was this?
Like 2012.
Okay.
And, so then I followed up. Yeah. And what happened was I kept doing these Kit Carter pieces, and people just constantly were asking me, hey, when are you going to do something with this character? When are you going to do something with this character? And I finally thought, I don't know, I think it was probably 5 or 6 years ago, maybe more, maybe seven. It was at a Chicago show. I remember I debuted what was I called a Kit Carter story print. And it was actually just like a newspaper, a Sunday newspaper strip, but it was comic book page sized, right? And it was just kind of a gag strip that had a little bit of an adventure in it, and it had a payoff at the end, right? And I thought, can I sell this as a print? You know, like a signed and number limited edition print, but it called a story print. And so what I did was I sold those. Yeah, it was, you know, some people bought them, so it was lukewarm. But what I did was I attached a digital, I had a special page on my website where I would put up these Kit Carter daily strips or Sunday strips, if you will. They didn't come out once a week, I can tell you that. They're more like every 6 months strip. And so if you bought one of these prints, you got the first six episodes. I was calling each page an episode. You get the first six episodes, and you could just go to this website and read them, and they're full color and everything, right? So it was like this continuity, but each episode or each page would be its own little thing, but it was part of a larger continuity. And so I did that, and then I was originally going to do a book or a strip, you know, because I had so many people asking about it all the time, and I just couldn't get a grasp on what I wanted to do with the character. Because the whole thing, it wasn't, a lot of times when you create something, and you know this, you create something with an idea in mind, like a story or something like that, right, that goes with it. This was just an image that I created, right? There wasn't any sort of,
like, you were just playing on a trope in a way,
right? Exactly. I had no, you know, I didn't develop the character at all or what I wanted to do. You know, I added Merv the Astro Chimp later. And so I couldn't really get a grasp on what I wanted to do. And when I started kind of doing these newspaper type strip gag things, I kind of got a rhythm. And then after I did a series of those, I got a grip on the character, and I kind of understood what I wanted to do with it. And so that still sat around, because I was thinking about doing that before Wraith of God, but I ended up picking Wraith of God, and wisely so, I guess. But I just kind of felt like after two pretty thick volumes of Wraith of God, I was like, I'm going to do something a little lighthearted. And so that's why I decided to go with the Kit Carter project. But it took me a while to kind of figure out what I really wanted to do with it.
Do you have big plans for this character? Are there going to be a lot of books?
Well, it depends. You know how it is. It depends on the response. It opened, it had a record opening for me on my campaigns, but nice. It's leveled since. And I don't know. We're trying to figure out. We always sit around in these big think tanks, right? And you go, let's see, why isn't this doing as well as I thought it would do? You know, and it, I mean, it's doing well. Don't get me wrong. I'm not complaining, but as compared to some of the other ones, and you go, well, you know, it's Christmas time, the economy sucks, did I launch too late, did I this, that? Of course, it all, you know, by the time you get to the end of the road where you're actually fulfilling, that's kind of when you look at the numbers and you kind of see, is this as popular as I thought it was going to be, or is it not? So I'm a long way from that. So we'll put this out, we'll see what the response is, then go from there. My immediate plans are to go right into Wraith of God 3 right after I publish Kit Carter. And then if I do more, you know, it'll depend on how well the book does, you know, when we get to the end of the line.
When you're building up something like this, is there any kind of, like, you know how Graham Nolan's doing, like, his Nolanverse? Is there, like, a Lopresti-verse at play here? Or are these two entirely, Kit Carter's going to tie into Wraith of God in some capacity?
No. Well, it's very, there's like 7 degrees of separation here. I have another property called Power Cubed. And I did that through Dark Horse 10 years ago, maybe. And it has serious themes, but it's a humorous book, right? It's a humorous adventure book. Yeah. And it's something that Kit Carter could tie into. And Power Cubed is something that could, in the right circumstances, tie into the other stuff I'm doing, which then ties into Wraith of God. So
very nice.
You wouldn't have Kit Carter show up in a Wraith of God comic, much like, you know, when Byrne was doing She-Hulk for Marvel in the 80s, and it was a humor book, right? She still crossed over, but it didn't work both ways. She had her own thing over there, but then when she appeared someplace else, maybe she was a little bit more serious of a character. And so that's kind of how I would play it if I ended up doing any sort of crossover. It would have to be a couple steps away, how all these things are connected. Yeah, yeah. But she would be at this end and Wraith of God would be at this end, you know what I mean?
Yeah. I was gonna say, because that'd be very creative if you were able to work that out and have it be a cohesive story that feels like it's not out of place and betraying some kind of character.
Well, you've got, you know, the thing is with stuff like that, when you start trying to cross over something that's a futuristic story, whether it's humorous or not, even if this was straight, you know, sci-fi, trying to cross that over with a Western or something, it would probably end up feeling forced no matter how you did it. And then you take something that's like Kit Carter, that's very irreverent, and something that's very serious like Wraith of God. I just don't know that you could pull that off without people feeling like it was some sort of weird cash grab or something, because it doesn't really make sense.
Yeah. Well, maybe you could do what gave birth to Kit Carter. You could always have like a cover pinup or something like that.
Yeah, exactly.
You didn't do a full story.
Well, you know what I did do in Wraith of God Bloodhunters, which we're shipping right now. That was the other challenging thing, and I'm sure this is something you deal with all the time when you've got multiple books going at the same time.
Oh, yeah, I'm fulfilling right now.
Yeah, so I'm fulfilling Wraith of God Bloodhunters at the same time trying to promote Kit Carter and, you know, work on the script for Kit Carter so that when I'm done fulfilling, I can start drawing. But, yeah, man, this is the first time I've ever doubled up, and talk about a lot of work and wishing I was 20 years younger right now. It's had a little bit more energy, but... that's proven to be a bit of a challenge in and of itself. And it's kind of, I think I've learned my lesson before I'm even halfway done with it, just going, I'm never doing this again. It's going to be, yeah. I'm going to make sure I'm completely fulfilled before I launch something
you're
else.
Like, so whose stupid idea was this? What kind of stupid boss do I, you're like, oh wait, it's me.
Yeah. Great. Well, it was a time thing, right? It was like, I didn't want to wait. I wanted to get it out. I was hoping to launch it in September, but getting the book Wraith of God back from the printers always ends up being a longer journey than I ever want it to be.
Yeah.
And so I launched Kit Carter in October, end of October. I figured I can't wait any longer because then I'll be too close to the holidays. And I still feel like I'm too close to the holidays. But if I had waited till I fulfilled Bloodhunters, I wouldn't be able to do Kit Carter probably like January or February. I'll be done fulfilling before then, but just, you know, waiting for people to recover from Christmas spending, you know, before you put something out there. And I didn't want to wait that long. And because I wanted to try and get to a schedule where I'm getting out two projects a year as opposed to just one. And so that's why I have on Kit Carter, I have Matt Ryan's inking. I'm not inking myself. I got Matt Ryan, who worked with me on Ms. Marvel and Wonder Woman and Justice League, and he's worked with them for years. Tremendous anchor.
Nice.
And so that is going to save me months of work just penciling and not having to ink it. And the pages we've got in already just look fantastic. So it'll be a really, really sharp looking book.
You got some cool looking stuff on that campaign. If you guys have not had a chance to check it out yet, the link is in the description of the show, along with Aaron's YouTube channel too. If you're not subscribed there, I recommend it. He's got a real fun channel. So as far as the space, science fiction, all that kind of stuff goes, where does that stem from in you? Were you always a fan of that genre?
Yeah, you know, I grew up in my formative years. I mean, I was born in 64, but I didn't really pay attention to anything until the 70s, right? That's when you know, you get into grade school, you're getting into junior high and high school.
Yeah.
And so what was really, really big in the 70s was there was this sort of renaissance period where, you know, Marvel, and I was a Marvel zombie, I didn't read that much DC, but DC was doing it too, where superhero comics were sort of, the Silver Age had blown up, everything was great, but then it started to die in the early 70s, and they were just scrambling to figure out, you know, what to put out. So you started getting all the sword and sorcery books, the monster books, and that's the time I was reading comics, is when all that stuff was coming out. And you know, Frazetta was, you know, doing Lord of the Rings portfolios. Lord of the Rings had made a comeback, you know, it kind of been, and in the 70s, you know, Bakshi did the animated film. Wizards came out, you know, in the 70s, another, you know, Bakshi, you know, sci-fi fantasy sort of combo film. And so I was just really into that stuff. I'd seen the Conan paperbacks that Frazetta was doing. All that stuff was all pushing fantasy and science fiction. Of course, Star Wars came out. I was a big Star Trek fan as a kid because my mom loves Star Trek. She likes fantasy. She likes sci-fi stuff. She doesn't like monsters. I don't know where that came from. But I did get the sci-fi stuff from my mom. She's always been a big fan of that, even as a kid. And so I got started watching Star Trek at a very early age. So, and then it just kind of, like I said, that sort of flowed into the 70s, my formidable years, not only as a reader and a kid, but as an artist, you know, where you're starting to say, oh, I want to draw comics when I grow up. And so I was, a lot of the stuff I was doing, I mean, I was a superhero fan, but my real favorite stuff was always the fantasy and the sci-fi stuff.
Yeah, yeah. That's interesting. I mean, it seemed like the 70s, at least looking back now, I think it had a bit more of a cynical tone with some of the sci-fi and the space fantasy until you get to the late 70s. And then you start having a bit more of a hopeful kind of sci-fi. You know, get the Superman movie, you get Star Wars.
You think about this, you think about the 70s, you had the Nixon presidency, which of course ended in disaster. Then you had Jimmy Carter, one of the worst presidents in the history of this country. And so, it was a very rough economic time. Yeah. And it was a very cynical time. And so I think a lot of that stuff, you had the end of Vietnam in 1974 was a final pullout. And it's like, so there was a lot of that stuff, I think, filtering through culture at that time and kind of made its way in to those books and things. So it was, I never lost my humor though. All of it. I'm cynical now, but not because of that, because of living in LA for 3 years. That's all it took for me to become a
where are you now? Cynic.
I'm in Oregon.
Okay.
But I went to film school in California, USC, and I went in there just super naive, you know, grew up in, you know, Suburbanville, and boy, I learned a lot very quickly living down there. You know, you couldn't trust anybody, and you know, I used to trust everybody, and I don't trust anybody. It's just like you assume everybody's trying to screw you over, you know. It's like, I hate feeling that way, but that is kind of where I'm at this point.
Even the it's strange because it's like the flip side of the coin to New York.
Yeah,
you know, I grew up in New York, and man, I never felt like I belonged there. I couldn't wait to get out. It's like as soon as I was born, it felt like, get me out of here, you know, and never going back. I've been up in New Hampshire now for 7 years and never going back. And before then, a couple of years in Massachusetts, maybe I think 5 or 6, something like that.
It's funny. So, my big dreams were as a kid, because I'd never been to New York City. I'd never been anywhere until I turned 18. You know, then a friend of mine and I, we road trip. I didn't even been to Disneyland, you know. We drove down to Disneyland in L.A. When we were 18, just kind of as a graduation trip to treat ourselves. And that was the first time I, you know, really went any place. And I was always dreaming of being a comic book artist and moving to New York. I had all these big plans, right? Because New York seemed like such a cool place. And when I first started going there, I liked it. But because it was so energetic, you know, it was like there was so much energy in the city, truly the city that never sleeps. And But I tell you, man, you spent a week in New York, even as a young man, I was just burnt out. It was I had to get out of there because it was just too much. It was sensory overload constantly.
Draining.
And now you can't even, you couldn't, now because of how the, you know, the crime situation and all that crap that's going on, it's like, yeah, ain't going to New York anytime soon. Going back.
Yeah, and I mean, I was born in Brooklyn. My family then moved out to Long Island, even though Brooklyn is technically geographically on Long Island. They moved out to Long Island when I was 5. And then we were always like a half hour from the city. But any time I would go to the city, even later on in life for conventions and going to New York Comic Con or Big Apple Con, I'm like, just get me out of here. Just get me out of here. And anytime I've ever gone back to visit family, because they're still all there, as soon as I cross that bridge, as soon as I cross into the Whitestone Bridge, I feel it's like Ghostbusters 2. I really believe there is some kind of pink evil river of slime running underneath over there.
You're probably right.
The energy shift is insane. It's like all of a sudden you get hit with the wave of like millions of miserable people.
But see, I always went there with hope. When I was there, because it was hope of me getting work at Marvel or DC, right? So I had this hope, and I never really noticed that sort of emotional oppression until, like I said, after about a week, you're just like going, I got to get out of here.
Yeah. I've done a lot of conventions. Every convention I ever done in New York City was like, oh my God, halfway through, I'm like, I got 2 more days of this. I got 2 more. Whoo. It's crazy. I'm like, every time I've ever gone back, and it's been the gap between me going back seems to get longer and longer because I just dread it. And, you know, I'm man. And then conversely, coming back, even the first time when we came up to New Hampshire, my wife's always loved it up here. And I never been, never in a million years. I always knew I wanted to leave New York, but I was like, New Hampshire. Yeah, not even on my map of places to go to. And she's like, oh, I love it. We got to go. You know, you can go up to the White Mountains and there's all, you know, it's just great up there. And she's always been in Massachusetts. And for her, Massachusetts was like the way she felt about that, the way I feel about New York. Mm-hmm. And we go up to New Hampshire and just crossing over into the state, I feel the difference. And then going up further north and being up in the White Mountain area was incredible. It was almost like a religious experience. And I was like, we have to move up here. And, you know, we're not in the White Mountain region, maybe like 2 hours, an hour and a half from something like that. But just being here, totally different vibe. And I can't possibly ever go back to New York, or I don't want to leave New Hampshire either. So it's strange how just being in certain places affects you that way.
Well, I think it's, I hate to say it has something to do with getting older, but maybe it does, because I'm like looking at small towns in Wyoming right now. You know what I mean? It's like, I want it, the older I get, the farther I want to get away
from
everything.
I hear you. That sounds good.
Everything, you know? And the great illustrator, James Bama, he did all the Doc Savage covers for a period of time there on the Bantam books. And he was a great illustrator. He went into Western art, but he was like, you know, a New York guy. And then he discovered Wyoming and moved there and started painting, you know, a lot of the Old West, American Indians, things like that, and just fell in love with it. And so I don't know, maybe I'm, I don't know if Shelley would be on board for the cold winters that you get in Wyoming, but there's something about that sort of picturesque landscape, being away from all the buildings and stuff, and just sort of enjoying the, you know, the natural God creation of mountains and all the beauty of that, and just open space and small town. I really, you know,
give me Smallville, you know, Metropolis, whatever.
Exactly. Yeah. When you're a kid, you want to get to Metropolis because it seems so cool. And then you get older and you're like, I can't take Metropolis. I got to get back to that small town again.
Absolutely. Let's see. Fritzy says, Pete, were you part of the Free State Project when you moved to New Hampshire? No, but we moved here in like 2016, which is when that kind of thing was going down. So I was just like, wow, that's serendipitous. It seemed to be interesting. You know, the universe works in mysterious ways. Let's see. Indeed. We got a question here in the chat. Wizard Sleeves wants to know, was Wrightson your first or major influence, Aaron?
He was probably my secondary, but he's probably the most major. It's a weird thing because I grew up, probably the first artist I really took note of was Frazetta. I used to, before he got into comics, we used to, malls were generally, were a new thing, generally speaking, when I was a kid. And, but they all had bookstores. And we had this one local smaller mall that we went to, and there was a bookstore in there called the Book Vault. And it was different than like Beat Alton and some of these others, because it seemed to get more quirky stuff in it than the normal bookstore would. So my parents would like, I would just say, you know, drop me off at the bookstore, and they would go do the mall thing, and they'd come and pick me up 30 minutes or an hour later, whenever it was. And I would just, you know, I'd walk around the paperback racks looking at all the Frazetta covers and the Doc Savage covers by, like I said, by Bama and others. And then they would have like tables set out, you know, they have like specialty books or and of course the Fantastic Art of Frank Frazetta, those Ballantine books had just come out, and I would see those and I'd be flipping through it and just be blown away. And they had like Ariel, that magazine of fantasy. I don't know how many issues they did of that thing, but I remember there was the first couple issues they had Frazetta interviews in them, and Barry Smith later.
Oh, I know what you're talking about. Yeah, yeah.
And so that they had that kind of stuff in this bookstore. And so Frazetta was really the first guy that I really fell in love with and was, you know, trying to emulate his style. And then I remember when I started collecting comics, I was probably 10 years old. So it would have been, you know, 73, I was nine. So it's like 73, 74 is when I started getting into comic books. And we discovered that there was these old bookstores in Portland that was the only place you could get back issues, right? Because it wasn't comic book shops yet. And so we'd go to these bookstores and find these old comics, which would just blow us away because, you know, we'd pick stuff up at 7-Eleven. And I say we, I mean kids in the neighborhood, you know. And we would find, you know, we didn't really kind of realize that where would we get back issues from, you know, it didn't really. And then we go to these bookstores and you see these, all these old books, and you're like, oh my gosh. And I remember one of the guys that ran one of these bookstores was talking to us about, keep an eye on this Bernie Wrightson guy. He's the next big thing. Right. And here I'm this impressionable 10-year-old. And this was post Swamp Thing, because Swamp Thing was 72. So he had all these, it was the weirdest thing. I don't know, someone had come in maybe and sold him his entire collection or whatever, but he had like 10 copies of every issue of Swamp Thing that Wrightson did. Maybe he was trying to get rid of them, I don't know, but he was like really pushing it on me. And I was like, okay, you know, I'll get these. And I like the monster books anyway. So then I started reading Swamp Thing. I thought, oh, this is so cool. And then I found out he was doing stuff in Creepy and Eerie magazine. Right. So then you're getting these really cool black and white stuff that Wrightson was doing. And I just sort of became obsessed with them. And I never kind of let go of Frazetta, but Wrightson became the guy for me. But he was so challenging to emulate as a little kid. You just couldn't do it. Right. So I had stages where I was a Jim Starlin guy for a while. I was a John Severn guy because I used to love King
Working
Cole.
Working your way up.
Yeah, and I would switch every once in a while. I had a Barry Smith period, right, where I was trying to draw like Barry Smith. And I finally just kind of immersed myself in Wrightson, and that's all I ever did. I bought Wrightson. I drew like, I tried to draw like Wrightson. And it wasn't until I probably was about 18, 19 years old that I had like everything the guy had done. I had all the portfolios, all the books, all the comics, all the magazines. I had everything that he had ever done. And I was like, every time I wanted to draw a rock, I would go look for Wrightson reference, right?
Wrightson rock.
Yeah, it was exactly. And I was like, he's like becoming too much of a crutch for me. So I got rid of my entire Wrightson collection, which was stupid because then I just bought it back 20 years later at an exorbitant prices. But I wanted to kind of break that cycle of, I remember doing a drawing and looking at it and going, holy crap, if I keep doing this, I'm going to be a Wrightson clone. And where's that going to get me? And so I kind of broke away from him. And then, you know, after I sort of got into comics, I, you know, you sort of kind of realize that what you can do, what you can get away with, what you can't, and kind of, and so I just started getting back into Wrightson again. And so if you look at my monster stuff like Garbage Man or whatever, you'll see the Wrightsonisms come out. If you see my superhero stuff, you won't see it at all. You know, so there, I mean, I would still say, you know, Neil Adams was
your monsters are very Wrightson-esque.
Yeah. And it really comes out when I'm doing monsters. But, you know, probably the number one guy for superhero work was Neil Adams. And then the number one guy for the monster illustrated work was Wrightson. And then Frazetta, you know, we're all in that mix. And it's funny, you just, because I don't draw like Neil Adams, but I do a lot of my layouts. And the angles I pick to draw from are very Neil Adams-esque. And a lot, you can see it sometimes. You go, oh, that's a Neil Adams panel right there, kind of thing. So that's, and then of course it's just an amalgam of just, you know, tons of other artists that I've seen and liked. And you go, ooh, I'm going to take that from Adam Hughes. I'm going to take that from Kevin Nolan. I'm going to take that from Travis. You know, and start incorporating those things. That, and you know, just your style just continues to evolve with these different elements.
Yeah, you know? Yeah. It's a whole amalgamation. You know, and I think that's what makes, I think, your own stuff unique, is because of all the influences you've taken over the years, and you kind of distill it down and you put a little bit of yourself into it, and there you go. You've got your own style.
It's always what you see then filtered through your brain and, you know, in your eyes, and it comes out a little bit different. You can see the influence there, but it becomes your interpretation of that. And you know, it's funny how you can see different things in different types of drawings. Like, you know, you can say, oh, God, I can see the influence there. You can see it, but it's really sort of inconsistent with me. It just depends on what I'm drawing. And then those certain influences will come out.
It's interesting. It's almost like, it's like an Italian person. As soon as they start getting upset, the accent comes out, the attitude comes out. The hands start going up.
That's my Italian. I always do, you know, the gesticulation with the hands. It's like you can't hide it.
I hear you. I'm half, so it's like I got that half in me. Where, you know, it starts coming out.
That's right. No such thing as a quiet conversation, right? It just starts to build, and you're like, you really. My wife's like, keep your voice.
The inventors of sign language, you know? It's like, and then, you know, it's like.
Exactly, it's just, you know, so it's the same way with the art, I guess, to a certain degree.
That's great. What about writing for you? What are some of your influences on that level?
I don't really have writing influences in the sense that I was never a really big reader. What I spent most of my time reading was screenplays, and when I didn't really study writing until I got to film school, and then I really started studying how to put together a narrative story, right? So a lot of my influences were film, right? And not necessarily. I got into the screenplays later once I found out how to get access to them. You know, at USC, they have the school library right in the middle of campus, and the whole upstairs is nothing but screenplays and movies that you can rent. You could rent these little video rooms, and you could like go rent Citizen Kane and sit in there for 2 hours and watch Citizen Kane by yourself and break it down and all this kind of stuff. And that's when I started really thinking about structure and how to put stuff together. But I was never a novel reader. You know, I read Edgar Rice Burroughs stuff, but even those aren't really novels. Those are, you know, those are magazine stories that were written as serialized stories, right? And then they just put them in these book forms. I'm not a guy who could ever sit down and write a novel, but I do understand how to put what I call entertainment writing together, and that's put it on a narrative structure for like a comic book or a TV show or a film. And I understand those beats, and I understand approaching writing from that aspect. You know, how do we open this up so that it has a real you know, a dramatic impact and things like that that you would do if you were making a movie, as opposed to you might have a completely different approach if you're writing a novel.
You definitely want to have more of a, I mean, hell, the splash page sums it up, a more of a splashy entrance, get people in right away. And some movies do that too, brilliantly. But yeah, the novel is a little bit more of a tiptoe into the narrative.
Build a lot of times, and
it is.
I was reading Jaws recently. I went back and reread Jaws because Billy Tucci and I were arguing about that in the book. Hooper gets, of course, eaten by the shark. Spoiler. He doesn't in the movie, but he gets it in the, but he's been having an affair with Brody's wife. So he actually sort of deserves it. And so when he's in the cage and the shark gets him, Billy goes, there was a scene in there where, Brody, the sheriff, shoots Hooper. And I went, you're full of crap. I mean, because I read the book in high school. I don't remember him ever shooting. But you go in and read, there's that scene in there at the where the shark gets Hooper, and then he surfaces, and Brody's shooting at him, and he clips Hooper in the neck. But you know, Hooper's already dead, so it's not like he killed him. And but I read this whole, like, the last couple chapters of Jaws again to try and find this, and I was like, I couldn't believe the stupid mistakes that Peter Benchley made, at least in terms of something you'd do in a movie, and you could see why it was rewritten for the film. But the, after Hooper gets killed and the shark gets away, him and Quint go back to shore. And he goes back and spends the night with his wife and all this kind of thing. And he already knows that they've been having an affair, so they're not getting along. And, you know, Quint is like, I'm going back out tomorrow to get him, you know, and Brody doesn't even have to go. But I think he's, you know, his home life sucks so bad. He's like, I'm going to see this through to the bitter end. And so then they go back out, and I'm like, how in the world? He just killed the suspense. You know, you got these guys right on the boat. Hooper's dead. The shark just ate him.
Yeah, it's a bit anticlimactic.
Let's go home and have dinner, and we'll come out tomorrow. Yeah. And then by the time they go out the next day, and then, Quint gets eaten, and, you know, the whole thing. And then you're kind of like, it just felt anticlimactic. It's like, why did you stop? You know, if you're in a movie or you're writing a comic book or, you know, something like that, you would never do that. And so, again, you know, the novel thing, I don't think in terms of novelization. I think in terms of, if I was watching this on the screen, I got to, you know, that's how I cut scenes out of my scripts. You know, I had a scene in Wraith of God, the first one, where Esther's talking to the sheriff. And it was, this is just a simple thing, but it was a 2-page scene, right? And I was like, this doesn't need to be two pages. This is like, I'm getting bored, and it's only 2 pages. It's like, so I cut it to 1 page, took that extra page and added it to the fight scene at the end with the werewolves. And, you know, it's much better served doing that.
Yeah.
And so I'm always thinking
the pacing is so crucial.
Yeah.
So exactly. Crucial. I just did the same thing recently too on a King Cryptid script. At the end of it, I'm like, I need the pacing to be a bit faster. I need another page for a fight scene as opposed to something. And I'm going through and editing it, and I'm like, all right, I'll condense these 2 pages into one and then shift it. I did exactly the same thing you did. Yeah. And the pacing was just like, all right, that's perfect. On point.
Yeah, because you can, when you're writing it, you don't necessarily feel it as much because you're like, oh, this dialogue's so witty. I'm so funny and clever. And so you write this long scene that has all these little great, you think, things of dialogue. And then you get, sit down, you go, hey, I'm done. And you sit there and read it and you go, wow, this scene is way, I'm boring myself and I wrote it, you know? So it's like, and you're like, you can start to feel where, sometimes I'll count pages and go, okay, like Wraith of God number one, for example, was 76 pages without the epilogue. So you got 76 pages, and I'm like, man, there's a lot of non-action in this script. I rewrote the beginning so that it would open with an action sequence. And that way, when you do that, you can sort of like Then when you get that character stuff in the middle that seems slower, we've already given him, you know, 8 pages of just fantastic, you know, action with the werewolves.
That roller coaster ride.
Right, exactly. Yeah. You're up and down, and then you want it to pay off, of course, at the end. And but it's amazing to me how often I do that, because I'll get an idea for something and I'll just start writing, you know, and I'll go from A to Z. And then when it's done, you can just go back through and just go, God, this pacing is terrible. This doesn't work. And I'm constantly rewriting up to, I mean, my letterers probably hate me because I'm like, change this page. And it's not their fault. It's my fault, because I read it with the balloons come in and I'm like, this needs to be changed. So.
Yeah, I'm glad I don't have to annoy anybody with that. I letter my own stuff.
Oh, dear, there you go. So you can just annoy yourself.
Exactly. It's fun at that point. It's getting to be creative. Because even then the art comes back, and I don't even write a full script. I do a story scene structure kind of thing. Mm-hmm. I don't write like full dialogue or any narrative or anything like that. And it's just mostly me describing the way the story's going to the artist. And a couple of different things here and there, like focus on that. This is the idea of what this character would be saying at this point. If it's an important scene where it needs to focus on a specific character or a certain thing that needs to be drawn attention to. But in terms of dialogue and everything else, that's mostly just up in here, and it's constantly evolving. So when the art comes back and then it evolves for a final time, there's times where I'll get the art back and scene structures occur to me to do different narratives or to have different dialogue that weren't there before because of the way it's playing out visually. So it's a lot of fun on that level, but I can't imagine relaying that to a letterer. I would probably drive them nuts.
Yeah. Well, I'm sure they're not, you know, but you know, it's like, when I find something, I can't let it go. You know, even if it's just like shortening a sentence or something, you know, it's like, you can just tell, you know, it's just like, God, that's too wordy. I need to get to the point here. But sometimes you don't realize that until you see it in the balloon and you see how much room it takes up, or you see, you know, you just go, you read it out loud and you go, boy, that did not work, you know? And so then I got to change it. And I change stuff when I'm drawing too, because I'll get the script, and I do write finished script even for myself when I'm drawing, but I'll go in there and change stuff, you know, as I'm going, because it just doesn't work. When I'm down to laying the page out, the artist in me doesn't agree with the writer in me. So therefore the artist in me is always going to win to a certain degree and go, this has got to be condensed, or this needs to be changed. And it'll be more dramatic and things like that. So
absolutely. A visual medium, you know, that's part of the reason why I don't put the dialogue down for the artist. I don't want to have them kind of be encumbered by thinking, well, you know, you got to fit in all that wordy crap that Pete wants to put there.
That's the thing that you catch yourself, right? It's like you think that's not that much dialogue, and then you look and go, holy crap.
Yeah, like you're like, it's two sentences. And then you put two sentences in the you're like, oh my Lord.
I know, I just covered up that dude's head. I'm like, I gotta edit it, you know?
Yeah.
Get to the point in a fewer words. So it you do sort of learn that. So I guess the point of all that is I always sort of look, even when I'm writing, I sort of look at things like I'm, like I said, watching a movie and just feel the pacing, and you can just kind of sense when it's working and when it's not working. I think if you look at, like, Marvel did this a couple times, and DC probably has as well. In fact, I know they have. Where they brought in like playwrights or something to write a series or a miniseries or something, or a television writer, and you're like, they just don't get it. It's like they're writing a play script for a comic book or a television episodic television script for a comic.
It's like they're thinking about passage of time, where it's like, well, that dialogue would take like 10 seconds. And you're like, yeah, but you just did like 3 to 4 sentences in 10 seconds. 3 to 4 sentences in a panel.
Yeah.
You know, and you keep doing that over and over. Oh my Lord. It pretty soon is just talking heads.
Yeah, I think it's valuable to me that I, you know, grew up reading comic books, because you really understand the language and the pacing and know what you liked as a fan, right? And why some issues you liked better than others. And it all comes down to that balance between action and soap opera and, you know, the efficiency of the dialogue and, you know, not being too verbose and all these different things that you know, you remember, oh, I was reading that comic and I got bored. Why did I get bored? Well, because of this, this, and this. And then you try to remember those things when you're doing your own stuff and avoid them. And so far, so good.
Nice. We got a couple questions here in the chat, so let's get to these. We got Fat Samurai says, who is your favorite writer to work with, Aaron?
I've had really, really good luck. I don't remember ever getting a script and saying, God, this blows. I'll tell you, the guy that I think probably... dang it, I just lost his name. My writer on Damage, and he also wrote, I did something else with him too. Venditti, Robert Venditti. Probably, but the guy everybody I ever worked with, Pete, I got to tell you, everybody I ever worked with, they always came to me with the same question. What do you want to draw? I never got stuck with writers who were just like, I'm doing this, you do this. They were always like, they wanted my input. They wanted, you know, and
that's smart, play to your strengths. Make
yeah.
It
and
great.
I would always tell them the same thing. Put MODOK in there or give me some dinosaurs. And so
MODOK, interesting.
I love MODOK. I don't know why, but I do. And when I was working on Ms. Marvel, Brian, Brian, last name escapes me. I think he's back into writing video games now, but he was the writer on the book, and he was like, hey, what do you want to draw? And I'm like, can we work MODOK in here somehow? And he's like, yeah, I think so. And so we had this big, long thing with MODOK. It was great. And then we did this sort of Monster Isle thing, and we also did that in Damage. I go, let's go to Monster Island. DC's got a Monster Island, don't they? And he goes, well, we can make one. So I'm like, always ending up with Jungle Adventure. I did that in my Sentinel Squad miniseries. John Lane was like, what do you want to draw? And I'm like, let's go to the Savage Land, man. And so somehow we worked these Sentinels into the Savage Land, you know, so I'm drawing these dinosaurs and
oh, that's
weird
great.
Stuff. I did that in Mystic on Cross Gen. Tony Bedard's like, what do you want to draw? And I'm like, can we do like a caveman jungle adventure? So you watch any series I draw, with the exception of probably the new 52 Justice League, there's a story arc that either has barbarians or dinosaurs in it or something
wow.
like that.
It's we like even your signature.
That. Yeah, Gail and I even did that in a Wonder Woman. It was the first thing she did. What do you want to draw? And I said, well, you know, we work in some barbarian stuff or some caveman stuff. And she ended up working in the 70s fantasy characters from DC, like Claw, the Unconquered, the Beowulf, and then what was that Ditko inked by Wood, the Stalker. And we worked all those characters into this barbarian storyline for Wonder Woman, and it was awesome. It was like one of my favorite things I've ever done, you know. And so
I'm guessing you love Warlord.
I did. I loved it because Grell sort of originally drew kind of like Neil Adams, so I was really totally into that. And although his outfit was a little fancy, I guess for the 70s it worked okay, but he looked like a professional wrestler, kind of like Killraven's outfit was kind of like, what in the heck is going on here? I wouldn't wear that in any era. But anyway,
dude,
yeah, he's a you know, wear that outfit, man. You're feeling pretty at home with your manhood. Yeah, so those things always, when people ever ask me, and it's funny, the scripts I've written myself, I don't know if I've done a dinosaur story yet. I don't think I have.
Oh man, you gotta
I've
do
got everybody else to do
you
it.
You gotta put some kind of like cosmic dinosaur adventure for Kit Carter.
Well, Kit Carter goes to, here we go, full circle. Kit Carter goes to Planet Doom. That's the name of the graphic novel, and there's monsters and giant reptiles and, you know, those type of things galore on there. So I'll be getting my giant monster fix, or you will as the reader. We'll be getting the giant monster fix in that book as well. So
there you go. See, Ronan Dust says, Aaron, were you at all influenced by Betty Page comics
no.
when designing Kit Carter?
No, not any. I mean, I looked at the stuff Dave Stevens drew, but I don't know that I ever even cracked open one of those Betty Page comics. I think, didn't, was it Jim? what was his name? I can't remember anybody's name. I'm grateful that I actually remember like either their first or last name. I can't remember both, but at least I'm getting one of them. Jim Silk, didn't he do those? Or maybe I'm imagining that, but no, not at all. I mean, I would say that you've got, most of it comes from the EC Comics, like I said, but then just elements of like Barbarella or...
Yeah, I was going to say, I see some Barbarella influence.
What was that? What was that? The Playboy centerfold that got murdered by her boyfriend? What was her name? She was in the film Star 80 that Bob Fosse did. But anyway, she was in a Galaxina, I think was the name of the movie. She was in a Dorothy Stratton. And it was a Galaxina. That was another sort of like goofy sci-fi, you know, chick movie. And then of course this has nothing to do with sci-fi, but it's the same sort of vein as 1 million years BC with Raquel Welch. Movie, it's just so ridiculous, you know. And so those kind of elements, then of course all the 50s B movies, you know, from where you had the sci-fi movies from The Day the Earth Stood Still, which of course is not a ridiculous movie, but War of the Worlds, and then I'm trying to think of the one that introduced Robbie the Road, Forbidden Planet, you know, things like that, Planet of the Vampires. I mean, all these kind of, you know, movies that I would watch that would show up on like the Sunday or Saturday matinee, you know, TV movie. Watched all that stuff, and it all of course, you know, is part of the influence to this.
That's great. That's interesting here. Norrin says, I know Aaron wasn't influenced by Metroid, but Kid Cudi reminds me of Samus.
I don't know who Metroid is, and I don't know who Samus is, so clearly not an influence.
Yeah, I guess if you want to look it up, take a look. I see it a little bit, but they might have like a shared inspiration, but it's nothing jarring. Nothing like that.
Well, what I tell people about Kit Carter is that's such a, it's almost a cliche trope, right? That the bubble helmet space girl. So I certainly didn't invent it. I'm just kind of like doing my own thing with it, you know? So it was definitely inspired by all this other stuff that I'd seen before, but there's not one particular character, I don't think, that, it's just a amalgam of, you know, because everybody's been doing this forever.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And I just, you know, like I said, I came up on with her. It's kind of a lark, and then now it's become something.
See, Wizard Sleeves asks, Aaron, have you considered turning your books into animation?
If someone wants to buy my stuff and turn it into animation, I'd be more than happy to do it. But I have not the patience for animation. I can tell you that right now. I took one animation class in film school and it almost killed me. I had like 140 drawings for like this 6-second thing I did. I was like, I wouldn't be, maybe if you're a, you know, if you do the poses and you get someone else do the in-between work. I mean, no one draws it anymore anyway, but that's too tedious for me. But I'd certainly be open to someone else wanting to do it.
I'm sure one day you could just put all your files from your comic into some AI and just be like, animate.
That's right, animate.
And then it'll just do a whole animated movie out of your comic.
I'll do a big, giant flip book. Remember those things? And just...
Yeah. Man, that was fun in like math class, just drawing like a little thing at the corner of the book and then be like...
Yep, exactly. But again, it took forever. I had this one guy who I knew in high school, they used to do these. He did these things called blood comics. He basically did stick figures, but he would basically just have two people with swords and they'd hack each other up and it'd be in black and white, except he'd use red to like fill up the panels with blood. And it was hilarious. He did like these little flip books where these two stick figures would be fighting. The one guy would chop the other guy's head off and blood would be spraying out. They were awesome, but I had no patience to do something like that.
Man, oh man. Yeah. Old school animation. Holy smokes.
Yeah.
That's a whole other, I can't wrap my mind around that. That's like magic and unbelievable patience.
Yeah. And it's like, of course, you know, if you grew up in art, for entertainment art back in like the 40s or, you know, 30s or 40s, you'd either be doing animation, or you would be doing, you know, illustration for magazines or whatever, but there wasn't like all these different outlets. So I was like, you're doing one or the other, pal, I better get used to it.
Yeah, seriously.
Of course, working with Chuck Jones would have been a blast, I would imagine. So.
Oh, man. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Spaceman says, Aaron, what are your thoughts on Grell's Longbow Hunters? Still one of my favorites.
I remember picking that up when it came out, and it was like kind of this big deal. In fact, it was when I was in L.A., and I went to Golden Apple Comics there on Melrose. And it was like, that was an exciting time for comics, that mid to late 80s, you know, when you had the Dark Knight you had the Turtles were showing up, the Tick, you know, and the independent market was cool, the Rocketeer, plus everything that Marvel and DC were doing was cool. You know, you had that, the Spider-Man Kraven's, the, you know, Final Hunt storyline that Mike Zeck did with Jim DeMatteis, all this stuff was coming out. And I remember when Longbow Hunters come out, and I was like, I was really into my collecting mode. So I was like, I didn't want anything to pass me by that might be worth money someday. And so I bought those up, those prestige formats, and I loved it. I thought it was a great series. I've always been a big Mike Grell fan. I thought his stuff was, you know, as a writer and storyteller was really top notch. And I liked it a lot. I can't remember a lot of the specifics, I haven't read it since then, but I do remember loving it. And then when they spun it off and Green Arrow got his own series off of that, Grell was writing, but he wasn't drawing. And I remember buying I wasn't a huge fan of the artwork because he wasn't drawing it. Someone else, I don't remember who was drawing it. And but I was so captivated by what he was doing with the character and the story that I you know, was buying the monthly after that. So I guess that means I liked it.
Yeah, well, it's fun series. Fun series.
Yeah, it was.
So my final question for you is, in your estimation, what makes a great sci-fi or space fantasy book?
Well, I guess saying high concept is kind of redundant, because it is already high concept in the fact that you're, you know, doing some sort of space opera type stuff. I think, well, there's two ways to approach it. If you're doing something like Star Wars, I think you got to be big, but you can't lose sight of the humanity of the characters, right? Because that's what's going to drive the story. But it's got to be big. When you're doing something like I'm doing, this is more of a humorous adventure. You're still looking for. It's almost like. To me, no matter what genre I'm working in, you take a good story and good characters and stick them into an interesting or a really overblown backdrop or scenario, whether that's, dinosaurs in a, you know, Skull Island, or if it's out in space. I thought a great use of sci-fi was the first Guardians of the Galaxy movie. I thought you well-placed humor for the most part, huge adventure, right? Large scale. And I mean, not just the weight of I might die, but just like the weight of the universe, right? And you can do that when you're doing sci-fi in space. It's no longer just, oh, this bad guy is gonna kill 20 people or he's gonna destroy New York City. Now we're talking about the whole universe is going to get destroyed, right? So you're becoming this, and the characters get bigger and they get more cosmic, right? So now you've got your Galactuses and you got your Beyonder and you got all these guys that you wouldn't normally deal with on Earth that are now, you know, major threats beyond. I mean, their planet becomes like their little city that they live in, and all the other planets are in danger because they're going to invade and they're going to do this. And if we don't get so. All the power and all of the evil or the menace, or it becomes so big that it's affecting the galaxy or the universe. It's no longer just affecting a couple of people. And that's what I kind of like about it, is you can just get ridiculously big with space opera, and your characters, you can do it with earthbound superheroes, but man, when you get out in space and you're talking about aliens and what happens over there, we have no idea. You can just start powering guys up to just next level and creating danger and scenarios that normal people just wouldn't even be able to fathom. How are you going to solve this problem, right? And I like to push the envelope so that it's just ridiculous in its scope, and it's the little, I mean, I'm not really, I don't know if I'm answering your question or not, because I'm not, it's not just one thing, you know, it's like.
No, I mean, you basically are answering it, whether you realize it or not, because it's a trick question.
But you have this ability to put in like, okay, all these guys are going to be aliens, and I'm going to make them look whatever I want them to look like, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And you got Kit Carter on her space station, right? So now you got this alien dude who's handing out uniforms, and he's a slob smoking a cigarette, but he's an alien, you know? And then you've got these little robots running around in the background doing something, or these little aliens, they have a job, then they're doing, you know, it's all those little details and stuff that makes it, you know, it's like it's like you're doing fantasy. It's like you're creating Lord of the Rings, which isn't sci-fi, it's fantasy, but it's the same type of thing. You're creating an entire world where you have no boundaries.
You
don't have to have humans if you don't want to, right? And you can make the, you know, like I said, the villains as big as you possibly can, because you're dealing with, you know, much larger landscape than just your home planet.
Super creative with it in terms of the designs and everything else. Yes. But you know, it really is like what you're talking about is essentially what makes every story a good story. You know, you got to have the characterization, you got to have the stakes at play, you got to have a conflict, you got to have all these kinds of things. And the bigger the playing field, of course, you know, the more grandiose and epic everything about it is going to be.
Right. And but it's fun. It's fun. Yeah. It's fun on a different level, you know?
Yeah. And then even getting to play with the concepts of technology and different species and motivations of beings that you can't even possibly imagine. What the hell would their motives really be? Would they be Earth-like motives, or would they be motives that we can't even comprehend why the hell they're doing what they're doing?
Right, and, exactly.
You know, yeah, so you could have so much fun with playing on that, because the reader could go, well, I'm going about this narrative thinking that these are all human being kind of motivations and wants and desires and needs and feelings and emotions. But then you could really pull the rug out from under people being like, no, these are aliens. They have nothing to do with what we feel about things.
Right. Exactly. They might have their own set of morals, you know, and what's,
yeah.
And it's a little trickier with what I'm doing, because it's not, you know, when I'm writing Wraith of God, it's dramatic and there's a moral to the story. This is more the fun and the humor is more important to me, that the jokes don't fall flat. Than, you know, I can put it in basically any narrative I want to, and I just got to make sure that that story that I'm telling is funny in the right spots and dramatic in the right spots and big enough that you feel like you're in a sci-fi adventure. But I don't know that you're necessarily going to read Kit Carter and go, wow, that was deep, man. It's more for the fun and entertainment of doing it. That's why I'm doing it, because it's a departure from what I've been doing.
Yeah, well, it looks like a lot of fun. And Brian, thank you for putting that link up in the chat right there for those that want to check it out. It's Kit Carter. Planet Doom is on Indiegogo. How many more days do you have left?
I think it's like about 10, and then we'll probably go in demand, because I never want to lose the opportunity of, you know, because that's the hardest thing, right? Is like I joke about this all the time. On the first Wraith of God graphic novel, it was like 12 months later, right? The book is out. It had already been shipped. I was working on Bloodhunters, and people coming up to me go, hey, I just found out about this book. Do you have any left? And you're like,
always
how
happens.
Did you just now find out about always it? I've been happens. YouTubing 4 days a week. I'm on every social media platform. But that's the way it is. I mean, it takes forever for some of the stuff to
You're thinking like, man, I must just be the most annoying human being on the planet right now. There's no one on Earth that hasn't heard of this 10 times by now. So, you know, and then the campaign ends every time. And you're like, oh, man, you were running that? Is that still available? Can I pick that up? And you're like, holy smokes. Every time.
Wizard Sleeves is asking, will I start fulfillment when it goes on demand? No, because I haven't even started drawing it yet. So it'll go... when you go into demand, then there's a period of time. That's when you're working on the book, right? And then when you get finished with the book, that's when you end the campaign and you go to the printer and then you fulfill. I'm shooting for April-ish to be getting that to the printer.
Nice. So,
wow. We'll see. It's 64 pages. It's 8.5 by 11. It's not comic book size. It's the, you know, the Marvel graphic novel size from the 80s. You know, that pretty standard 64 pages, 8.5 by 11. There'll be a hardcover and softcover versions of it. And so it's a throwback, like a lot of the stuff I do. It's, you know, you kind of go back to your youth a little bit, and everybody grew up at different time frames, right? But I go back to when comic books were fun and exciting and they were doing different things. And I, you know, it's like, I want to do a Treasury edition at some point. I don't know how in the heck we'd ever mail it, but I would love to do like a Treasury edition just to do it, you know?
Yeah, and so that'd be
cool. I just thought this would be a book that would work nicely formatted in a larger package. So,
yeah, that's awesome, man. And Dan, it's a, I mean, you know, it happens to everybody. There's times too where I'm like, oh man, you're running a campaign, you know, and it's just, that's the way the technology works, the algorithms, everything else. Everybody's got certain things going on. Some people are just, you know, depending on what's being constantly pushed on the timeline and the feed of whatever, you know, the main feed of social media, some people are like, right. Nope, not looking, you know.
I am constantly, stuff is going by me by other, like Kerry Nord did a book recently. I had no idea, that I just happened to see a post that he put on Facebook that I happened to come across, and I was like, oh my gosh, I better get that, you know? And if I had looked the other way, I would have missed it, you know?
Yeah, it's so crazy. Dr. Mask is a newsprint, Treasury edition would be awesome. Oh, look at that. That'd be cool.
You control the newsprint market, Pete.
Apparently. I've got the keys to the city of newsprint.
Yeah. I want to do the Savage Tales type magazine, black and white magazine, too. I mean, they got all these things I want to do, and you just hope. And that's the thing, it takes so long to get the projects out that I'm hoping to squeeze them all in, you know, before I burn out or die. You know, whatever comes first. Exactly.
that's every day, right? You're like, well, I'm gonna try to do this and, you know, until I burn out or die.
Yeah, exactly.
Because you know? it what other option do we have? Right, you know, just keep doing what you got to do until your time is done.
Time's up. Yep,
absolutely.
So that's what we'll do,
man. Aaron, thank you so much for being on tonight, brother. It's always a great conversation with you.
I enjoy talking to you as always.
Yeah, love every minute of it. Thank you guys in the chat for being here too. This is so awesome. Another great conversation. We'll do another one in less than 100 episodes, or technically less than 95. Aaron was on episode 30. If you wanted to catch that conversation, that was a fun one too. That's of course in the backlog of comic book radio episodes, and we'll have to do this soon. Maybe sometime in February.
There you go.
Something like that. That sounds good.
Hit me up anytime, Pete. I'll come on. Love talking to you.
Sounds great. Sounds great. All right, everybody, go check out Kit Carter. The links are in the description of the show. And also go subscribe to Aaron's channel on YouTube. That link is there as well. Really fun channel. Good stuff. Bob. Yeah, he didn't even drop an F-bomb. Look at that.
Are you known to drop F-bombs? Are you kidding me? I never drop F-bombs.
Yeah, I don't have to give him a warning. I don't even have to let him know. I know Aaron's good. He's a pro. He's a classy dude. Everybody have a wonderful evening. If you like this show, give it a thumbs up. Make sure you subscribe to the channel, ring the bell for notifications. I'll be back on tomorrow night with Gerald Lang. We got a big weekend. I'll be back on so Gerald Lang tomorrow night at 9 o'clock. We got Isaac Bell on Saturday at 9 o'clock, and then we got Razor Fist coming back on Sunday at 9 o'clock. So a big fun 3-day weekend with some great conversations. And tonight kicked it all off with Aaron Lopresti. Always good stuff here from Aaron. Everybody, until then, have a wonderful night, a great evening, and an even better tomorrow. Everybody, take it easy. and see you soon. Thank you, guys.